Our presenter today is Painter Master Elite Aaron Rutten, and we're lucky to have him to run through a full review and show you how to actually do some workflow and painting with these tools, because he knows Painter inside and out. He's a great person to do this. Let's get started.
Sounds good. Thanks for joining us, everybody. I'm going to be going through my favorite Painter 2022 features. If I'm going too fast or you have a question about anything, feel free to comment in and let us know. Well, let's go ahead and dive right into it. So here in Creel Painter 2021, I have a little bit of customization. This might not look exactly how it looks when you load it, but what I've done here is I've opened the brush selector, or the full view brush selector, which can be found in the window menu under brush selector. And then I have just some layers here. So this is a painting that I did. I was inspired by an AI generated image and it had some weird little silhouettes and things in it. And so I decided that I was going to do a painting of that. And I did that in a live stream on YouTube. So what I want to show off here first is I really opened this up and I was like, what is this layer 19, 18, and 20? I have no idea what these are. And prior to Painter 2022, if I wanted to figure that out, I'd turn the eyeball on and off and I'd try to figure out where that is. And well, if you have a really good eye, you can see where it's at, but it's just some little stuff here near the rocks. But now if I were to hold Alt and then click on that eyeball, suddenly I've isolated that layer. And so I can see exactly what's on that layer and where it's at. And if I Alt click again, or Option click if you're on Mac, then I can un-isolate the layer and put everything back the way it was. I can also select all three of these layers by holding Shift to select contiguous layers. And now I can perform actions on multiple layers at once. So I can show and hide that group of layers to try to figure out what they are. And then of course I could go through and name them if I want to. So moving on to the next little topic here, you may notice in the brush selector, if you've come from older versions of Painter, it looks a lot different. There are many, many, many more brush categories. And in older versions of Painter, some things were grouped together. You might have had crayons, chalk, and pastel all grouped together because they have a similar behavior. Now everything's broken up into its own category. So of course you have contés or crayons, and you have pastels, and they're all separate. You may notice that the names have been changed a bit too. They're a bit shorter. Some redundant terms, like let's say pastels, has been taken out. You know these are pastels because they're in the pastels category. So that's probably the one thing that I think is going to take the most getting used to. Fortunately, you can filter through brushes, and we'll come back to that. You may also notice that there are a few brush categories that are new. There's the oils bravura category. I'll open that up and I'll use that to do a little bit of painting here. Let's say above this canvas layer on a new layer in the sky, and I'm going to use rough oil. I'll sample one of these colors from my sky. And these brushes work really well to just get a nice stroke with a lot of character in it without having to do too much. They also don't require a lot of fancy settings like some of the other oils brushes. Real wet oils have diffusion. There's the artist oils, which have their own behavior. And if you don't know the properties or how to modify those properties, then they can be a little bit tricky to work with. So I could put in a couple of little clouds like that. And then I could maybe blend it a little bit using the rough edge blender. Might even just merge that down with the canvas and then blend it. Just to kind of fade some of those colors in. There's also the chip bristle. And I could get, let's say, kind of a grassy color and maybe put in some grass and stuff like this. So see, just with a few little strokes, I've got some grass. And I don't need to spend too much time on it. I don't need to know how to play with any of these properties or anything. I can just paint with these brushes and get some really interesting results. And you can see all of the different character and textures you can get out of these brushes. What's nice is that the oils are all grouped together. and the watercolors are all grouped together and so on. And it makes it really easy to find the brush you're looking for. The other category that's new is the watercolor Sumi-e or Sumi-e watercolor. And that has some watercolor brushes that kind of similarly can give you some more exotic or more interesting effects. You know, there's a lot of things like scumbling and leaf blades and different textures. So these are going to be the more exotic things that watercolor can do, like dripping or using dab stencils and stuff like that. Are there any questions at this point about any of the stuff I've covered?
Sorry, took a second to unmute. No, we're good right now. Some questions came in, but I'm just addressing as we go along here.
Okay, cool. So we're gonna switch over to a new composition then. Lots of screens going on here, so I have to, you know, you'd think three monitors would be enough, but it's just not. So we'll shuffle a bit here. So this is a painting of a mountain that I created in Corel Painter 2022. I used a lot of the various captured dabs. And so I'll kind of just give you an idea of some other things we can do using some of the new features. The first thing I want to do though is I want to switch to my custom Corel Painter workspace because I'm just more comfortable in that. It's going to look a bit different, but it's also going to give you an idea of how I've integrated these new features into my workspace. So this looks like the cockpit of the space shuttle, no doubt. I have some custom icons and I have a million buttons. You don't need to go this far with your workspace if you don't want to. I'm kind of a Corel Painter nut, so I like to customize. But that's one of the things I like about this application is that you can do that. One of the features that I really, really love, not the zoom tool, take it easy, zoom tool. If we open the navigator, we can now view our composition in grayscale. You might be thinking, why is that a good thing? You just took away the color. No, that's not it. By viewing your artwork in grayscale, you can see the differences in contrast. You can see the value structure of your painting. Now, ideally, you're probably going to want to put this on another monitor because it's helpful to see this large and to see your painting large. Can't do that very well on one screen. In order to make your navigator grayscale, up in the top right in the sub-dialog menu, you can display in grayscale. Another way to do that, and the way that I like to do it, is just to make a custom shortcut button. And you can do that for nearly any command in Corel Painter. To do that, you go to the window menu. Then you go to Custom Palette, Add Command. Then here it's going to ask you which custom palette you want to put that into. If you've never created a custom palette, then you can select New, or if you just want to create a new one, you can do that. I have many custom palettes that I've created here, so I'll just put it in a new one. Now it's going to ask me which command I want to select. What do I want to add to that custom palette? So I can go to the Navigator, select Display in Grayscale. It enters here under Menu Item. And then I can click on Add. Click on OK, I get this custom palette and it has a display in grayscale button. And then if you want to, you can right click on it and set a custom icon like I've done here. And I just went into any old application where that has a type tool and made a little icon. I'll hold Shift and drag that to get rid of that custom palette and that shortcut. And so I've talked about how, you know, you can make your artwork grayscale, but like, why would you want to do it? How do you actually use that in a way to improve your artwork? I'm going to make my artwork smaller and my grayscale preview larger so you can really focus on that. I'm also going to make it so I can see. Gonna take a little bit of shuffling here. There we go, that'll work. I want you to be able to see my color picker as well. So things that are in the background or farther away from you should typically be lighter than things that are in the foreground. And that's how you get a sense of distance in your artwork. So I can just kind of illustrate that using the dropper tool here. So let's say I'll sample on some of the trees that are up on the mountain in the background. If you look on the value slider here, value represents the lightness or darkness of a color. And if you're not seeing that and you're seeing RGB, then you need to set the option correctly here in the color palette. Right now that's at 109. Now, if I sample a color, one of the darker colors from the tree that's a little bit closer, now that's 65. Now, if I do this darker color, now that's 40. This darker color is 51, 37, and so on. So the lower the number, the darker the color, essentially. So all those shadows are getting darker as they go into the foreground. Now, just to kind of give you a feel of the wrong way to do it, so you can see the difference, I'm going to select a new brush that I created called Flat Captured. And this is what I use to paint a lot of this foliage. So things are small here, but I will zoom in a bit so you can see how this works. I'm going to create a new layer. I'm just going to sample some of those colors from my background. And I'm going to paint those tree colors in the same area or the same plane. So I'm just being a little bit sloppy here. This is my sloppy tree. Now you can see in the grayscale version, it fits in. It looks like it should be back there. It works in the color version. Then if I take that using the layer adjuster and I move it into the foreground, all of a sudden, what is this thing? It doesn't work. It either needs some more shading or some other colors. It just doesn't make sense as a tree. So this tree is never going to fit in unless it goes back into the background. And I can move it, you know, pretty much anywhere on this plane as long as it's not going in front of something else. And it'll look all right back there. And that's because before I pick the colors or while I'm picking colors, I'm always sampling other colors and just thinking about how dark they are. And if I need to make adjustments on layers, I can do that. This particular composition, because I wanted to make it less complicated for the webinar, I took all the layers out of and I flattened it. But normally I'd have the mountains separate and all the tree plants separate, and I'd be able to make adjustments to those. You know, for example, you could go to effects. Well, here, let's do this. Let's move it into the foreground. And we'll go to effects, tonal control, adjust colors, and we'll darken it. Try to get it kind of about where we want it. And then look at it in grayscale, look at it here. It looks pretty good. Not perfect because it needs some other colors. It needs some more highlights and stuff, but at least it fits in better that way. So that is, in a practical sense, how you would use the navigator. You might also have situations where you have, oh, let's say something like a banana, where the banana is yellow, but then it starts to fade to green near the stem. If you were to, by eye, pick a green that fades to the yellow, that green might end up being too light or too dark. And so by viewing the banana in grayscale, you can see whether or not that green you picked is the same value as the yellow, which it should be. So I will delete that horrible tree there that does not fit in. And let's see where we're at on the next lesson here. While we're on the topic of this brush that can paint with captured dabs have been enhanced, and it makes a huge difference in being able to randomize your brush or get a lot of character out of it. So I've created a custom palette drawer here called Dabs, and it's incorporating the captured dabs palette or library. You can find that in the window menu. And you want to look under brush control panels, brush shape, captured. The dab profile is also added in here, and the dab preview. This combination of palettes then makes it really easy to see the changes that I'm making to the dab. And it's just all dab stuff. So I can really easily go in here now. I've created my own dabs library. This brush, it's basically just a brush that is intended to have a different dab every time. So, you know, when I'm painting leaves, I'll sample this color here, and let's just paint some over here. when I'm painting leaves, I might want a different style of leaf. I might want the same exact paint and the same exact behavior, but then I'm going to be painting a different tree. So this is the same tree, right? Or very similar. But let's say I want a tree that looks completely different. It has a different type of leaves. It has a completely, let's even make it bigger here. It's a completely different shape, like that. I can get a different color. And this is just for example's sake, so you can see this here. I'm doing more sloppy trees. And you could have a completely different type of tree. So really quickly and easily, I can just go through and I can blend these together to create combinations of dabs. And so I have a lot of control over this. Now, I can even customize the dab to the degree that I can control different effects. Like I can erode the dab. So see, this dab was normally square with a little bit of chunkiness taken out of it. If I paint with it, I get something that still looks like a leaf effect. Let's make that brighter so you can really see that. But if I start to erode that, it's the same dab, but it's not, because now I'm starting to kind of eat away at it. So on the fly, it's like I'm editing this dab. And I could use that to my advantage. Let's say I want some really, 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 really fine leaves. Just barely sprinkle on there. I don't have to go find a completely different brush. I just make one little change here to this slider. And all of a sudden I have a completely different looking dab. And that's great. A good analogy to this is if you were using, let's say, a piece of chalk, some of that chalk would break off and the tip of that chalk would be changing constantly as you're drawing with it. So you wouldn't always be getting the exact same mark. And it's repetitive strokes. This isn't a good example of that, but repetitive strokes that don't have any character that all look the same that make digital art look digital. And that's something that a lot of applications, especially Corel Painter, have done a good job of moving away from by adding randomization like this. So now you can paint and you can get that same amount of randomization or a similar amount of randomization that you'd get from smashing a bristle brush on the canvas from a digital brush. And I think that's great. So this is one of those things where, you know, it's, you can make a very, very slight tweak to your brush and get some completely different results. And I like that. If you want to, if you don't want the bulk of this whole palette here and you know that you're only going to switch between these two dabs for this brush, hold down shift and just drag that dab out to a custom palette and hold shift again, drag out its friend. And then all of a sudden, you don't even need that open on screen. You take this, you put it right over here or wherever you want it, and you're good. You can go right in between those two dabs quickly and easily. Now, if you have a dab effect applied to a brush, keep in mind that, you know, if you're doing a lot to the brush, you're making a really big brush, it's going to take a minute for that brush to kind of rebuild the dab. So you may not even want an effect on the dab at all. So just be sure to turn it off. There is a warning message that will appear if you're switching between dabs. I have that disabled, but it will let you know that you've switched the dab, but the effect is still applied. So that's actually very helpful. If there aren't any questions, I can move on to the next little demo here.
Aaron, there, I did answer some of the questions that came in, but it might be useful for other people. So I can't remember who asked right now, but the layers panel, the previews, somebody just had mentioned they're quite small on your screen. Is there a way to change that preview size, the thumbnail?
Absolutely. So I have actually disabled the layer previews. My logic is that, well, here, let's do this. Let's open this other one that has a lot of layers. So I use tons and tons and tons of layers. The reason why I don't show thumbnails is because even if I make them really large, I'm not really getting much from that. And then all of a sudden I have to scroll really far to find what I'm looking for. So if I were working on a composition that had only a couple of layers, then it would make sense. But because I use so many, I want to be able to see all of my layers or as many as layers as I can. So I set that to none. You do that from the top right of the layers menu under thumbnails. For me, it's more helpful to have a descriptive name. So while I didn't follow my own advice 100% here, I usually name all of my layers something that makes sense. You know, like the light for this little drone over here, that's drone light. I don't have to hunt for that. I know exactly where that's at. Or if I want to know where the sun is, you know, it's right there. So it's not hard to find anything. It's easier to look and see the word sun than it is to look at a square and try to pick out a little white dot, if that makes sense.
That's great. Thank you for showing that. Some of the other things I'll save until the end because people are asking specific questions about libraries and brushes that come with subscription and whatnot. So I'll hold on that.
Okay.
Let's see here. Ollie is asking, are dabs different than custom brushes in the way that the dab applies a shape to the characteristics of the selected brush? That was a mouthful.
So all brushes are dabs. Any of these brushes are really just a shape that repeats. And if that shape overlaps itself enough, then it gives the illusion of a continuous stroke. So right now I'm using a captured dab, but if I hit Control B, bring up the general brush controls, this is where you can get in and you can really change any brush into another brush. So right now I'm using captured, but if I change this to circular, watch what happens in the dab preview. Now I just have a circular dab. So all captured really is rather than a circle that's generated that can be manipulated with various properties, this captured dab is something that either comes with Corel Painter with the dabs that have been added to it already, or you can make your own captured dab. You could even paint right now on the canvas and just capture a dab. So it isn't different. All it really is the shape of your brush. And really any of these are just brush shapes. That's why they're under dab types.
Thank you for explaining that.
Mm-hmm.
There was also a couple questions about what kind of tablet are you using?
This is the perfect time to do the webcam thing. So let's do this.
Great.
So I'm using, it's not blurry again. Good. Okay. I'm using the Wacom Cintiq 27 QHD Touch, which is a display tablet. So you can, you know, use your pen to draw directly onto the screen. It also has multi-touch, so you can zoom in and zoom out. But I have used many, many, many different types of drawing tablets. But I do like the display tablet the best. Going back to one that doesn't have a screen feels very difficult, though I know in the past, you know, I've made tons and tons and tons of artwork with the most basic tablet you can imagine, because that's what I could afford. And so it's not the tools that make the artist, you know. You need to just use whatever you have. So don't get the idea that you need a giant screen like this. I think that's something that's more geared towards professionals. And they do make smaller versions of these, like the Wacom one.
Thanks, Aaron. I think we're good to move on for now.
Okay. So the next thing that we'll talk about are some static bristle enhancements and some enhanced cover, or the enhanced cover method, and how those two features work together. So I'm going to select a brush that I created called Pixel Spray. And I will pick, just for the example's sake, so you can really see what I'm doing, I'm going to use a color that just shows up nicely here, like this white color. Maybe it snowed right here. You might think, well, there's already a pixel spray brush. What's the point in this? Well, this is actually a static bristle brush, and you can't really tell because the bristles are broken up into little pixely chunks. What's cool about this is then I have a pixel brush that doesn't spray out at an angle like the airbrush style pixel brush. And so I like that. And I was pleasantly surprised to find that although I don't typically use static bristles very much, there was a way to completely change the look of the brush to make it very non-static bristly looking, if that makes sense. So it's this particular combination. I'm using static bristle enhanced cover, which is new. The legacy cover and enhanced cover are very, very similar, but enhanced cover is better because it's been enhanced. How has it been enhanced? There is anti-aliasing on the dabs. There is alpha blending, which is less likely to create unexpected mixtures of color. There are the new grainy subcategories, grainy flat and grainy hard edge flat. It's also optimized for your CPU and GPU. Noise was added to reduce artifacts and soft brushes, and there's also brush loading support. I know that sounds like a lot, but basically, long story short, in my opinion, any brushes that were using legacy cover, you should just convert to enhanced cover unless you prefer the look of legacy cover. This will just be better. So anyways, I got to look like this, but then let's play with some other settings and let's see what else we could get. How about if we go back to the general brush controls and we change this to grainy hard alpha blend. And then we change our paper to something different too. Let's say hard laid paper. This might be kind of hard to see, so maybe I'll make a new canvas here. Oops, I have to change back to my paper because I changed my canvas. Okay. Got to have the right kind of paper for this to work. Now I'm getting these bristly strokes, but they're kind of broken up. So see, I can use lighter pressure to make thinner, so fewer bristles touch the canvas, or heavier pressure, so more bristles touch the canvas. And I think that's a really nice effect. You know, you could use that to put in directional shading, like if you were doing like perspective or something, or you could use it for hatching. You might even be able to use it for grass. Now, one feature that you'll see me using a lot is the ability to press delete or backspace, and that will instantly clear the contents of a layer. Or if you have a selection active, it will clear the contents of a selection. So I can make a mess and then just keep removing it. It's super easy. And that's probably the feature that I use the most. So as you can see, I'm able to get a lot of interesting results by using, or unexpected results even, from dynamic speckle. So like one way I might use this, if I reset it and pick the correct paper, I could use a look for this if I wanted to not have to fiddle with those settings, but I can use it to add some little details to the ground that look like little pebbles or sand and things like that. Or if you did want it to snow, you could use it to put in snow or rain and things like that too. So next, unless there are any questions specifically about what I just did, we can check out another topic.
Yeah, go ahead and move on. You must be explaining everything very well because there are minimal questions.
Cool. Okay. Here's another painting of a nebula. Now, this what we're going to be demonstrating here is the ability to create mixed media effects with watercolors. This painting was not created with watercolors. This was some blenders and palette knives, maybe some kind of oily brushes, and definitely some airbrushes, but not watercolor. No watercolor was used here. So what I want to do is I want to create a mixed media effect where I take this dry paint and I make it wet, or I make it have a wet look to it. So brushes in Corel Painter 2022, some brushes can now work on watercolor layers. And typically watercolor layers only work with watercolor brushes. So in order to find the brushes that are going to work, you'll want to use filters. Now I'm using my own custom brush library here, so I'm going to switch to the default Painter 2022 library. And then you'll be able to see all the default brushes. Now, if I click in the top right under this filter icon, looks like a little funnel. Here I've expanded the filters and now I can apply various filters. I could apply my own favorite brushes if I wanted to, and this will let me isolate brushes that I want to use. There's also Painter Masters, and I won't go through all these because I've already talked about that in the video, but let's check watercolor compatible. So now any brush that you see here, any category that or any variant, or any of these are going to work on a watercolor layer. So you can see that's a lot of brushes. That gives us crayons, gives us charcoal, all kinds of things that you think wouldn't normally be able to interact with watercolor. But the brush that I want to use, I'm going to disable this filter, is actually a custom brush I created. And it's called Wetness. And this is just using the wet method. So it's nothing super special. So let's do this. Oops. Gotta turn my touch off here. Let's, on this overlay layer, which is set to the overlay composite method, this is a watercolor layer. So what I did is I have my canvas here. This is the original painting and it's all on one layer. I duplicated it. You can right click, choose duplicate. And this is kind of a fancy way to do this. You could really just like start painting with brushes on watercolor layers and you don't have to do this, but I just wanted to show you like in a practical way what you could do. So I duplicated my artwork and then I converted it to a watercolor layer. You do that by right clicking on the layer and you lift, or not lift canvas, you convert to watercolor layer. I have a shortcut for that here. And when you do that, then it can interact with watercolor brushes. So I set that to overlay. I also set it to 50% opacity. And you'll notice if I show and hide it, it's kind of making the colors pop a little bit. It's altering the colors a bit, but that's okay because I have an idea of what I'm going to do with it. So now on that layer, with this wetness brush, I'm going to select white. Now with wet brushes and other types of brushes that use gel and buildup and things like that, white is kind of like water or wetness. You're not, you know, when you paint with watercolor, typically you don't paint with white watercolor. White is reserved. You paint around it and you leave the white space there. So that's kind of how this is working. This brush works best on layers that use the gel method. I'm getting this warning message and I could disable this, but I left it enabled because I want to just kind of remind you of that. So I can automatically create a gel method, but I don't want to do that because I already set this to overlay. So I'm going to continue with the layer unchanged. Now on this overlay watercolor layer, I'm going to paint with white. And this might be kind of hard to see, so I'm going to be really extreme about this to get it to really build up. And you can see my nebula is dripping and flowing. Hopefully you can see it. Let's zoom in and let's see if you can really see this here. Now, this is going through GoToMeeting. It might be compressing some of these little flowing things and you might not be able to see all the intricacies. So we'll do a before and after just so you can get a feel for like visually how it's changed. So I'm going to do an undo and a redo. So even if you couldn't see all the diffusion or all the paint flowing, which is actually really cool to look at, the end result is what matters. So I got kind of an interesting texture that I added over that. If I show and hide it, I was able to take a painting that was not watercolor and was not made with watercolor, and I've given it kind of a wet appearance or made it interact with watercolor. And so I could even take watercolor brushes and I could paint onto this and add to it. But let's take it one step further and let's take a look at how we can make that watercolor flow in a specific direction. So the trick here is that you want to select a paper and a flow map that have vertical features. So for example, wood grain normally is at zero here. So it's horizontal, but we'll set that to 90 so it goes vertical. And then the scale and the contrast are going to affect, you know, you could imagine that the drips are going to follow these paths here. So you want the drips to be thinner, then you make the scale smaller. If you want it to be wider, then you make it bigger. Then you want to select a flow map as well. Organic verticals works well, as does horizontal flow. We'll just use organic verticals. And so now, if I paint here, I do it on the correct layer though. Not a hidden layer. I'm going to undo a bit here. Get it, but maybe I'll just do this the faster way. I'll go to revert. There we go. On this overlay layer, continuing with the layer unchanged. Now when I paint, those features are going to kind of flow downward and I'm going to get these streaks that look like they're kind of dripping down. Maybe kind of hard to see through GoToMeeting, but you can try it at home. And again, you can play with the scale and the contrast, and you can get all kinds of really interesting textures and results. I think that's kind of fun. And then you can also, of course, you could adjust the opacity of that layer if you wanted it to be more subtle. So see how I can blend it in just a bit, or I could make it way too extreme. So that's why that's on a layer. Are there any questions about mixing media with watercolor?
I'm trying to get through the list right now. Uh-oh. I'm falling a little behind here. There is a question asking, are your custom brushes available for sale or for free?
There is a small sampling of brushes that are free on my website at aaronrutten.com. It's a better way to explain it is that I have a membership. So like if you're a member, then you get access to just all the random junk that I create for Corel Painter. So that includes the workspace and brushes and all that.
Okay, great. Teresa is wondering, how do you favorite brushes?
So let's favorite a brush here. Let's go to Painter 2022 brushes. And so you can really select any brush you want here. There's a lot of different ways to do it. First, you could click on the heart here up next to the brush. You could also right click on the brush and you could favorite it. You can also hold Alt or Option on Mac and click on a brush, and that's really the fastest way. So I can go through and favorite a bunch of them like that. You can also favorite the entire brush category, or you can unfavorite all brushes in a category. There are lots of different ways to do that. So if I favorite a few brushes here, let's say these, and then I filter it by my favorites, now all I'm gonna see are these brushes, and that's really cool. Also, while we're looking at this, I'll unfavorite these. You can also show the Painter Masters favorites, and these are all brushes that kind of collectively the Painter Masters have agreed are the most useful or the best brushes in Painter, our favorite brushes, I guess. So there's some good ones in here that I use a lot, Just Add Water and Blur Diffuser. On that note, Blur Diffuser used to be called Diffuse Blur, so you may notice the names have changed, and that might make it a little bit tricky to find what you're looking for, but you can always use your friend Brush Search. And so if you remember that it was like called Diffuse something, you know, put in a descriptive name. Don't put in oily, because you're going to get a bunch of brushes called oily. That's not helpful, but try to think of the most descriptive word in the brush, and there you go. You've got all your different diffuse brushes there. And one of them is a blender. So we can move on to the next, unless there's more questions about that.
The one question that came in was just speaking to your watercolor variations and how interesting they were, but they're looking in particular for just like a traditional wet kind of brush. So I think it has more to do with, you know, interacting with the paper textures. You're choosing very expressive kinds of textures?
Yeah, there are, I mean, there are a lot of the default brushes that, you know, that can give a wet look. For example, if we, you know, it depends on the look you want. This is worth mentioning. So the names of the categories of watercolor have been changed a bit. What used to be digital watercolor is now fringe watercolor. And then we have pigment watercolor here. So pigment is the one I was using. But let's say we want, like, you can kind of get a feel of all the different types of looks you can get. But let's say runny. And let's pick a color that's appropriate for this here. So you can let the paint kind of run and diffuse, and it does start to look wet. You know, I was more or less putting the texture of wetness over my nebula. I wasn't applying paint per se. I was applying water. So it's like I took the painting that was dry. A good analogy is, like, let's say you take an oil-based medium and you put turpentine or terpenoid on it. It's going to blend what normally wouldn't be water soluble. But there's tons of other ways that you can get, you know, like the wet method and these pigment watercolor brushes work much differently than, let's say, real watercolor, which can give you even different results. A good example here would be if I go back to my watercolor brushes. And then I'm going to do this watercolor drips. You can get the paint to flow and run down. And that might be kind of hard to see. So let's hide this.
It actually shows well.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so we can get some flowing and running like that. You have to have an idea of what it is that you want to accomplish and set the settings or create or select the right kind of brush to give you that effect. You know, I could have splatters if I want to do splatters. And we can let those run and dissolve. So there's a huge range of wet effects you can get. It's just a matter of finding the right settings or the right brush to give you that look. And there's no shortage of them. You know, you can, aside from all the brushes that you can select that are just default brushes here, you can create your own brushes. And, you know, there's probably an almost infinite combination of settings you could choose from. Because there's all the brush properties, all the brush technologies, and so on. I'll revert that. Were there any more watercolor questions, or should we move on to the next little topic here?
It depends on how much detail we want to get into. There is a question about how do you control the degree of dripping for a dripping brush? And, you know, I know that starts getting into digging into panels and controls.
Yeah, I think we should give a shout out to Skip Allen and look at some of Skip's videos and courses. Okay. Because yep. he's the Corel Painter master, and he can explain it much better than me. It's not something I can explain in 15 minutes.
Okay, no problem. And I didn't think it was, but yeah. I thought it might be worth throwing out there.
Yeah.
Okay, so guys, we can guide you to Skip Allen creates a lot of watercolor tutorials. So I can provide a link to those for you. And I think, let's see here. Yep, with that, go ahead and move on, Aaron.
Oh, okay, so this is the last little section here, and then we can, if we have time, we can do some more questions about whatever you guys want. So now I'm gonna talk a little bit about the new anti-aliasing and size library features. So I'm gonna use this sketch of a heart-shaped rose to demonstrate. In the regular or default Corel Painter brushes, there is a new brush in pens, and it is called Smooth. Now, this is maybe, I don't know if it really replaces scratch board or not, but it's maybe kind of an alternative or a competitor to scratch board. Scratch board is one of the most popular brushes for doing inking because it has a very opaque stroke, or it can have an opaque stroke and a very, very smooth, nice, sharp edge without being like too aliased or jagged looking. Smooth pen is using the enhanced cover method, which is new. So by using enhanced cover, we get access to some other controls that we can access here in Dabs. So I'll make a big stroke with this, and you can see it has a nice smooth edge. If we go to our zoom tool, we want to make sure we turn off any kind of screen smoothing here so we can really see the crispness of that edge. And I can go through and easily feather that edge and make it softer, can make it harder, can make it really, really hard and aliased, or I can make it just a little bit anti-aliased, like down to the point to where I don't see any jaggedness and I get the exact edge that I want, because there's different reasons to get different hardnesses and softnesses of edges, but it also can come down to preference sometimes. I won't go into vast detail about why you want to anti-alias, but ultimately it just comes down to whether or not you want jaggedness on your edges or not. Most of the time, you're probably not, because it just looks kind of sloppy. So I'll reset this brush now that we know how we can tweak it. And this brush works really well for inking. So I can go through and I can ink with this brush. What I like about it and what sets it apart from scratch board is that scratch board works pretty well for drawing lines. I'm being kind of fast about inking this here. But where scratch board falls short is if you're using it to do like flat colors for something. So I'll quickly make a thing here. Let's say I was going to fill this in with some shading. You can see just by the nature of the brush being a rendered brush and the shape of the dab, it can leave these little speckles, which you wouldn't see if you were inking, but you definitely see there. So if we go to smooth now and we do the same thing, you're not going to get those speckles because the dab is different now. It may have some other characteristics that you do or don't like, and so it's not necessarily replacing scratch board, it's just a different type of brush. But now you could use that and have full control over your edge. You know, like let's say this was going to be a sphere, and then I was going to add some shading to it with an airbrush with preserve transparency enabled. You know, I can think about how sharp I want that edge to be. Maybe it's a bit too crisp for my liking. Oops. So then I will get my. I have another version of this. I switched my library here. Smooth fill. This is basically the same brush, but I tweaked it a bit. I can tweak the hardness. So I can paint a similar object and add similar shading to it. But then if we look at the edges and how they compare to each other, you can see one is softer and one is sharper. And so you may or may not want one or the other, depending on your style and how sharp you like your edges to be. You might be painting something in the distance and you like the feel of this brush, but you just don't want it to be so sharp. Well, then there you go. You can, you know, you can paint background details and have a lot of control over your brush. On that same note, if we're talking about inking and all that, there's also the size library, which can be found under brush control panels, brush shape, size library. Now, this is the size library. This is a custom palette where I pulled icons by holding shift out of the size library and put them in here. So I have my own brushes. I don't need this many brushes, and if you want, you can delete these or rename them or even add your own. I only really need a few sizes, so I've added them to my custom palette here. And then if I reset this brush and make a stroke. Oops. then we can go to the size library. Get the right brush here. We can do a fine 1 pixel brush, which you might not be able to see. And we can go to the fine brush. And we can go to do this also. I'm at a weird zoom level where that was making that look kind of funky. We have a small brush, medium brush. So when I'm doing tutorials, I'm usually saying, you know, select the small brush, select the medium brush, select the large brush, and so on. And that's really just relative to the size of the canvas. You know, there is no small, medium, or large. If I make this canvas much larger, my medium brush might all of a sudden become a small. So this is just relative to the scales that I typically work at. But if you're doing inking, it can be really helpful because let's say on every panel of your comic, you want exactly a 4 pixel brush. Now you can always go in and you can have that 4 pixel brush and you don't have to worry about not being able to find it. And then the brush that you use for finer details like hatching, you can have that set up. And then you can really quickly and easily just click here, 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 rather than having to go up and change it in the size slider. So that's all I have for my presentation, but I'm happy to answer questions.
Okay, I've got a few here, and then I might ask you just to show a couple things in app that we've had many questions about. Mm-hmm. Ollie is wondering, and I can't say for sure because every artist is different, but what brushes do you think that comic book artists use for inking? Would that be the ink category or pens, or it could be a combination of many different brushes?
Yeah, so for me personally, I was using the scratchboard tool, which I kind of demonstrated. It just has a hard edge. So what you're going to encounter when you're inking is basically this. You're trying to put a line around a color. So you have an outline, right? And this, let's say this is your color behind it. Now I put my color on a separate layer because that's the way I like to do it. But other artists will use the paint bucket and they'll put their color on the same layer. And there's a whole reason why I don't do it that way. This just looks more professional. But this is what you want. You want a clean line with a clean edge that's not feathered or anything like that. And this is, I guess, a generalization because not all drawing styles are the same. But typically when you see cartoons or comics, nice sharp clean edge, the fill doesn't go outside of it like that. It doesn't leave a gap, you know, and not fill in all the way. And that's not an always thing because I do see lots of cartoons where that is the style. But that's what you want. So you can't get that same result from a brush that has a feathered edge. Like if I use the airbrush, even if I set that to 100% opacity, I've solved the opacity problem where I don't see my background color mixed with my line, but then the edge is too soft. So then when I go to try to color it, or using a paint bucket or something, I have to constantly fight with the softness of that edge. So this just makes it easier. So you want your line to be opaque so that your color doesn't show through your outline. And you want your edges to be nice and crisp so that you don't have any issues trying to fill in, or you know, you don't want things to look too blurry. Unless you do, because there are some things that you want to be blurry. So, but really, I would just use, you know, I would use either the scratchboard tool or the smooth fill, depending on what I feel like using. They're both about the same for inking in that regard, except smooth fill, or the smooth pen, I should say, which is the name of the default version. Smooth pen gives you control over the aliasing of the line. And that really comes down to personal preference, I think. Some people like a little more, some people like a little less.
Yeah, I agree. That's why thank you for pointing some options out. Mm-hmm. Taya's wondering, and this could benefit others, we saw the size library, but what other ways do you have that you can adjust the size of the brush, like keyboard commands and...
Oh, sure. There's lots of different ways to do that. So let's clean up some of this mess here. My favorite way, and yay, we get to do the camera thing again. Let's see, let's switch it to the right one though. Okay, so my favorite way to do it is to hold down Control and Alt on your keyboard. And when you do that and you tap and hold with your pen, this circle that you see is going to represent the maximum size of your brush when using maximum pressure. So if I press down as hard as I can, then considering the feathering is part of that diameter, that's what I'm getting. Make my brush smaller, and that's the diameter of the brush. So Control and Alt and drag, that's how I resize my brush. Another way to do it, obviously, is to go to the size flyout, and that's, you know, how you would do it in most applications. But you do have a slider where you can hold Control, and you have a little bit more precision over that. You can also use the right and left bracket keys if you want to incrementally make your brush smaller or larger. Maybe able to see if I'm pressing left bracket, or here in the stroke preview, you can see the brush getting larger and smaller incrementally. And you can set those brush size increments in your preferences.
Thank you. Let's see here. Can you show us once again how you modified the strength of the dabs?
The strength of the dabs. I think you might have meant the dab effect, but if I'm wrong, then let me know.
Yeah, actually, I'm not sure. I think it was when, I don't know if it's the strength slider that you can adjust in the dab panel. It was a while ago, so maybe that person can let us know
sure
exactly what aspect they're talking about. Do you have Cintiq commands that you find useful, or do you have any videos or anything where you've set up your Cintiq for a painter?
As far as the express keys?
Yeah.
So on my, I'll try to kind of show you here with this. On my pen, there are two buttons. This one on the tip, I use to resize my brush. So I set the top button to modifier, Control and Alt. Occasionally I will just use my keyboard out of habit, but that's typically the way I, or what I use for that button. And then this other button is set to right click, because you need right click a lot for most applications. But I also do keep a mouse handy. It's just right, like right down there. And then I'll have my pen in my hand and I use my mouse. And then, you know, of course I have both, because some things are better with a pen, some things are better with a mouse. And then as far as the Express Key remote, I don't typically use it. It's not that it's a bad device or anything, it's just, I'm not sure that I wanna hold something, nor do I wanna press buttons that are up, because I can, I don't know if you can see this, it's right over here, but I can stick it to the side of my tablet and it'll stay there. And this remote will work on with other tablets too, not just the Cintiq. I might not be able to show you this. Maybe the cord will be long enough. Oh, great, it is. This is what I use for most of my shortcuts, and it's called a Stream Deck. Usually you use it for live streaming. You can program this to do nearly anything, and you can make like little labels for your buttons. It actually has a built-in screen and then like actual buttons that you press. So I have Corel Painter stuff in there, like for example, you know, I might want to do multiple commands at once. Like, I guess in an older, it's not such a good example now, because you can just press delete to clear a layer. But in older versions, let's say I had to do Control A to select all, delete to clear, and then Control D to deselect the selection. I could do all three of those commands with one button using the Stream Deck. But there are also all kinds of other peripheral keypad things that you can use to get a similar effect. I think ultimately what's important is that you do have some sort of shortcut peripheral, because it does make a difference. But which one you buy, it just kind of comes down to preference on like how you like to have it on your desk, or do you like to hold it? There's all kinds of different ones. There's ones that look like phasers from Star Trek, and it's pretty crazy.
Okay. Oh gosh. So for those of you who would like a review of everything that is new, we do have those very short and sweet feature videos on the website that succinctly go through everything. You know, Aaron touched on everything in the webinar, but if you just want to hone in on, you know, only the new panels and the new features, I would recommend that you watch the videos. They're very quick to review. The other thing is we've had a lot of questions just about upgrading and if I had brushes from older versions, can I get them into 2022? So on the front of upgrading, if you would like the best price, my recommendation is to upgrade from the previous version that you have. So if you have 2021, right in the welcome screen, you're going to get the loyalty offer from within there. Also, if you've signed up for our email list, you should be getting emails about the special offers that we have as well. We have both perpetual and subscription options for people. But the welcome screen is kind of a one-stop shop for everything. If you want to see your offers, if you want to know with your subscription when you have free brushes, because we do give you 2 brush sets a quarter. If you click on the store button and you filter to free, that's going to show you all the brushes that are available for you to download. Likewise, if getting your brushes into the new version, let's say you upgrade to 2022, from the help menu, you can say restore purchases, and that will bring all the brushes that you had before into the new version of the product. So those are just in a nutshell, kind of, I'm trying to answer some of the questions that came in quite a few times. The other thing that we didn't talk about is the legacy brushes. So from the current brush library, we only have Painter 2022 right now as a library option. So if you want the legacy brushes, it's the same way that Aaron just showed you from the store and filter. The brushes will show up for you to download if you wanted legacy brushes. And everybody probably saw that, but I'm too busy talking when when Aaron was showing that, and I have a panel over the front of his screen. So let's see, I think that addressed almost all the questions. Let me just do another quick check here in the panel. We have people saying, thank you, Aaron. All right, and then there's one question that just came in that's asking, I understand you can put Painter on more than one device, which you can do with subscription. And with subscription, that can be Mac and PC. So just to address that question there. And I think we did a pretty good job, Aaron. If anybody's question did not get answered and you're still hanging around, let me know right now. Go ahead and shoot it into the question panel. Just kidding. Yeah. Thanks. Yep.
Thank you, everybody, for tuning in.
Thank you so much, Aaron. That was great. I know we're 5 minutes past the hour, but I appreciate your going into so much detail on everything and making sure everybody's questions are answered. We appreciate you for everything you do, Aaron. It's a pleasure to work with you. And to everybody on the line, this has been recorded. So if you want to rewatch it, I'll have it up on YouTube in a couple hours. Takes a little while to process. You can watch it via GoToWebinar as soon as it's done if you want to. And any other questions, ping us in social media, or you can send an email to paintervips@corel.com. And with that, I think we're done with our launch webinar.
Thanks, everybody.
All right, everybody. I hope you have a great day. Aaron, enjoy some downtime.
We'll do.
This afternoon, and we'll see everybody soon. Take
care. Bye, everyone.